Welcome to this exciting video on the science and engineering of Spider-Man. This video is the third installment in the engineering of comics series. The first video was on the engineering of Iron Man. I would highly recommend you to watch it. On this channel, Synergy Files, we aim to inspire budding engineers and technicians for a better, more sustainable world, so please do subscribe to our channel. So, Spider-Man, the immensely popular Marvel character, has enthralled audiences for decades. While his spidey senses are handy, but it is his clever way of using the web in different situations that entertains audience the most. Let's begin with a closer look at the web slinger's web. There are two methods of how the web is produced in the comics and even in the movies. The first one is that the web is organically produced inside the body and comes out from the wrist. The second method being the use of mechanical web shooter that has to be topped up with web cartridges. Strangely, the first method is more plausible than the latter, and the following segment will explain why. The web material shown in Spider-Man comics is super strong, it has high tensile strength, it is flexible, and not to mention sticky. In real life, a spider web is also very strong, and in fact its strength is higher than that of a steel fiber of a similar size and cross-section. The spider web is made out of silk. Silk is an organic compound made out of silk protein. But can silk be artificially produced? That's the question. And the answer is yes. However, artificial silk is no match for natural silk. The industrial name for artificial silk is rayon. It is the oldest man-made fiber, and its strength is almost half compared to natural silk that stands at 1 GPa. It has to be noted that even for creating rayon, materials like cellulose is needed that has to be extracted from biological sources like wood pulp. The only artificial fiber that can be chemically produced and will match and even surpass natural silk's capability is DuPont's famous material called nylon. But nylon weighs twice as much as natural silk, so at this point it is relevant to introduce a very important concept in material engineering called the single crystal material. Single crystal material for any substance, be it iron, silicon, aluminum, or even carbon, is much stronger compared to their multicrystalline version. When materials solidify from a molten state, the particles inside, the atoms and molecules, start arranging themselves in a particular structured fashion. The process is called crystallization. Normally, when crystallization begins, it can begin from several sides of the molten material, particularly from those areas that are in contact with cooler surfaces. Therefore, this results in the formation of several crystals in the same material. The point at which two different crystals meet creates a crevasse or an interface. This interface is also called a grain boundary. This grain boundary can be considered as a crack at a microscopic level. Therefore, this region is a weak point in the material, and if the material was subjected to forces, it will break at the grain boundaries. But what if we are able to control the crystallization process so that we don't allow multiple crystals to grow? We only allow a single crystal to grow from one direction till it spreads along the whole length of the material. This is possible, and this is how single crystal materials are made. One can imagine that single crystal materials are hard to produce in large dimensions than in smaller sizes. And that is the whole point of carbon fibers. We are able to produce single crystal carbon fibers that are much stronger than any multicrystalline material of the same size. Therefore, we can add these carbon fiber to composite materials to enhance their strength. They are lightweight and strong enough to be used in aircraft frames. In fact, modern aircrafts have thrice as many composite materials with carbon fibers than metal or alloy-based components. In the solar aircraft, Solar Impulse 2, these carbon fiber composites have been used for making the fuselage and the wing. The wingspan of Solar Impulse 2 was longer than that of a Boeing 747. The remarkable thing was that the weight per unit area of this composite was less than that of paper. So these thin carbon fibers are strong enough to handle body weight and are not a problem to manufacture with today's engineering. Getting them to stick to a surface is a challenge. Which brings us to the next point. How does Spider-Man crawl along the wall? How does he get the traction against the smoothest of surfaces and even crawl against the ceiling? Is that even possible? Well, in nature, yes, it is possible. We have seen insects and even Gecko, a lizard, do that in real life. If we use materials with high friction coefficient in gloves and shoes, then we can stop a person sliding down a building, provided we have the person apply a force and strongly push against the building wall. This pushing force against the building is also called the normal force and is needed for friction force to build up. But how would a person provide the normal force against a ceiling? That is not possible, so we can discount high friction materials. Similarly, we have seen suction-based climbing tools shown in the movies. These are effective against smooth surfaces, but not as effective against rough surfaces. To gain the fluidity of movement as depicted by Spider-Man's character, the answer lies in another force of nature called the van der Waal force. It is a well-known scientific phenomenon that when two molecules or particles get close enough, van der Waal forces take effect, which keeps the particles close together. In the case of a gecko, its feet are covered with millions of ultra-thin fibers. Because of the finesse of these fibers, they get close enough to the contours of the wall for the van der Waal forces to take the effect. The resulting force of attraction allows the gecko to stick against the wall or ceiling, countering the effect of gravity. While in nature, these ultra-thin fibers exist, but can they be made through an engineering process? The answer is yes. A gecko-inspired polymer tape has already been made. To look at the details, just search for Smart Gecko Tape. The link is in the description. This tape was made for robots to lift objects without applying too much gripping pressure. This tape again has these tiny microfibers that get attached to a surface when a sliding force is applied instead of a normal force. Likewise, when the sliding force is removed, the adhesion force diminishes and allows the material to detach from the surface. One of Spider-Man's ability is to sprint up a wall. Well, as long as the sprinting movement provides a sliding force, it is possible to do that through this material. In the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movie, these microfibers were shown to stick out from Peter Parker's hand when his DNA changed. So the movie has some scientific accuracy in that the microfibers are the only way Spider-Man can achieve what he does. So what's the verdict? Well, with the engineering and technology available today, and through a bit of improvisation and inspiration, many of Spider-Man's abilities can be realized. And with this, the video on the science of Spider-Man is concluded. If you like the video, please do like it and share it with friends. If you want to add to this video or disagree with the content, then please do add your ideas in the comment section. This allows for a healthy discussion through which everyone learns. If you're interested in learning more engineering through the science of comic books, then a complete course will be available soon on the Udemy platform. I will add discount vouchers to that course in the description section of this video. Finally, please do subscribe to our channel to get more such videos in the future. Thank you for your attention.